Hello everyone, my name is Alexandru Vasile. I'm a PhD student at the University Polytehnica of Bucharest, and in the following minutes I will try and deliver a presentation on the topic of a simulated annealing algorithm for stiffness optimization. This study is part of a project we are currently working on. It involves creating 3D structures that are heterogeneous and are based on epoxies. They should be composed from hard and soft microscale subdomains and will be designed by modeling such as to enhance overall toughness without compromising its strength and modulus. During this presentation, I will make a small introduction, talk about the problem formulation, about the algorithms we used in order to solve this problem, and a few conclusions at the end. As you know, optimal design has always been a topic of interest for engineers, and since the technological developments that emerged in the field of nanofabrication, imaging technologies, and additive manufacturing, interest has also sparked in this domain. Researchers are trying to mimic the behavior of certain materials found in nature, or are trying to create structures that display novel properties that surpass those of traditional materials. In order to do so, engineers, through numerical modeling, create algorithms that aim at optimizing structures. If you can see the stages of optimization, we mainly focused on the last one, material optimization, here. And the scope of our project, as you can see its name right here on the slide, it's to be able to create 3D structures that are based on an epoxy polyamine resin, creating using a base and a hardener. The project is here. You can visit the website and find more information here. In order to support the modeling effort and develop the concept and tools required for microstructure design of parts that will be used for inkjet reactive printing, we started with a very simple problem. We considered a 2D domain, since the layer height of the epoxy is in the order of micrometers, made up of two different materials for which we know or we can determine the Young modulus. It is assumed that the Young modulus of the soft material is 1000 for our problem, and the one of the hard materials is 10 times that. The goal is to find the material distributions in this domain that ensure the best possible mechanical properties. For this purpose, we identify a representative cell of the domain. We can see that in figure 3b. And to further simplify the results, we analyzed only a quarter of the cell due to symmetry conditions. You can see that in figure 3c. We can have a fixed percentage of material distribution, as we have on our problem. So we have 50% soft, 50% hard materials, or consider different ratios. Figure 3c shows the boundary conditions that were applied to our cell. You can see that it is made of 16 equal elements. We constrain the x equals 0 and y equals 0 lines on the model, and used couple sets on the other two lines here and here in order to introduce forces or displacements on those. For a linear elastic analysis, the stress distribution for each finite element is variable if you do not consider a reduced integration element or a stress mediation on the whole element, but for simplification we consider that the stress is constant on each element, as you can see in figure 3f. In order to not differentiate between plane stress and plane strain, we consider that the Poisson ratio for each element is zero. Finite element analysis were performed by using the PyAnsys software under a MIT license. As we worked in Python, we tried to make everything as easy to reconfigure as possible, so we would not spend a lot of time with different runs of the same program. We defined a set of input parameters. You can see a list of those on the slide. As you can see, they are related to the plate geometry, the material properties, the Young modulus ratio, Poisson ratio, also about the type of finite element we used. In our analysis, we work with quad 8, sorry. The type of forces we used in our analysis, the value of it, also about the output parameters. We only provided in this presentation the most important one, which we used for our objective functions, which is the effective stiffness on X and Y. Another important one could be the total deformation energy, but we haven't used them in our analysis just yet. You can see the formulation on the slide for the effective stiffness of the material. The first algorithm we tried to tackle was the greedy algorithm, which was presented earlier today. And in order to assess the accuracy of the results provided by it, we needed another program that could show us all the possible solutions for a given problem. This is the role of the brute force algorithm. It can enumerate all possible candidates for a solution and check whether each candidate satisfies the problem statement. In our case, this algorithm should provide all possible configurations of materials, material 1 and 2, and verify their effective stiffness. Here on the slide, we have the relations that give us the total number of combinations we have for a 2D domain composed from n numbers of finite elements. To get a sense of why we can only use this algorithm for a small scale problem, we can see the table on the right. We can see that for our problem that is made up of 4x4 elements with 8 cells of material 1 and 8 of material 2, which is this row right here. We have a time duration for running of about 27 minutes. This is on our configuration and with the PyAnsys software. Just to mention here, we also noticed that using the PyAnsys software, we could make the program run faster by an estimated 11% compared to the time we created the same code in MIT PDLE software in Ansys alone. To get back to my point, we can see why we can't use this algorithm for a larger scale problem, such as a grid made up by 6x6. We can see the time estimated for running this simulation, and it's not feasible. Now let's get back on our problem with just 16 cells. Here we have an example. We ran the code, and this is the values we got for every single combination of materials. If we look at the graph, we can point out four configurations that provide the maximum value for our function, which has its description right here. And the layout of these material distributions are presented on the slide. This is the value of the objective functions function, and these are all the four layouts for the distribution. We have material one, which is the blue color as a hard material, and material two as a soft material. Using the results from this chart, we could analyze the results obtained when we ran the greedy algorithm. We made four different runs and obtained the following configurations. So with these values on the second row here, these layouts. As you can see, none of them points to one of the four global maximums we got on the brute force run. The second one, this one, comes close to it, but the other three ones converge to solutions that are not nearly close to an optimal solution. That being said, we can reiterate the conclusion from our previous presentation that the greedy algorithm does not guarantee convergence to a global maximum, as it stops if the next iteration does not find a higher objective function. In order to avoid this problem, we needed to modify the algorithm in such a way that it would not block in a local maximum, as we tried to implement a simulated annealing algorithm, which is similar to the greedy one, as it uses the same method of consecutive iterations, the difference being that it is able to accept worse solutions. Let's consider a part of our previous chart. Let's consider that this is it. All these points being values of the objective function of material distributions. If our greedy algorithm starts here, it will make two iterations, reach this local maximum, but then it could not find a higher value on the next iteration, this one being the next iteration, so it stops in this barrier to local search. In order to reach this global maximum, we needed to modify our problem a bit, so we defined another two parameters, one called acceptance probability and the other one called temperature. The acceptance probability depends on the difference between the new solution and the old one, and the temperature value. Due to the way it is calculated, when the temperature is higher, it is more likely that the algorithm accepts a worse solution. The temperature description, which is this one here, it can have different formulation. We use the function that takes into account the number of iterations our program has run up until that point. So the relation for the temperature, as it is shown on the slide, where number of maximum iterations is a defined parameter that decides how long the algorithm should be able to look for a better solution. This is a scheme that explains how the algorithm works. Up until here, it is similar to the greedy algorithm, the difference being this last part of the cycle, where we calculate the acceptance probability, generate a random number between 0 and 1, or define a probability value under which we will not accept any solution, and compare these values, and if the acceptance probability is higher than the value, we go ahead, decrease the temperature, and start over with another population, which we then evaluate the objective functions, run consecutive iterations in order to find the best material distribution and reach this point again. If the acceptance probability is lower than the random generated number or our imposed value, the program prompts to exit and shows us the output. We ran a couple of tests to see which algorithms works best. And this is a visual comparison. We can see the greedy stops here on this row. We have the greedy algorithm. We started from the same configurations for the greedy and for the greedy modified with simulated annealing elements. As we ran the greedy, we saw that it stopped just after three iterations and reached this value for the objective function we defined. When we run the simulated annealing algorithm, we see that it continues after it reaches this local maximum with another distribution. In fact, it reaches four new local maximums, another one here, here, and it stops at this final value. It's still not perfect because if we remember the value of the global maximum, we can see that this one here, it's not the global maximum, but it's still closer to it than the first greedy value. This is another test. We see that the greedy algorithm only ran one iteration, while the simulated annealing reached a higher value and ran 11 iterations. And in order to get a better sense of how it works, we made a chart. We ran 10 more tests to get an overview of the results with slight modifications to the simulated annealing algorithm. In the graph and the table, we can see the results. With the green circles, we have the four maximums obtained through brute force. Red is the greedy algorithm, while orange and violet are the results from the simulated annealing algorithms. They differ between them in the sense that the first one, the orange one, compares the acceptance probability to a random number between 0 and 1, while the other one compares it to an imposed value, in our case 0.5. If the value is closer to 1, the acceptance probability has a higher chance to be lower than the imposed value, so it's a fast simulated annealing, while if the value is closer to 0, the chance of acceptance is higher, so the algorithm searches for a longer time. Here, if we went with an imposed value of, let's say, 0.001, the algorithm transforms itself in a kind of a brute force algorithm, but it also increases the time needed in order to obtain a value. We can see that the algorithm with the lowest score, whose points are lower on this chart being the objective function for all the material distributions on the 4x4 grid we made, is the greedy algorithms, with this red dot being lowest on this chart, followed by the simulated annealing, where we use the random number as the acceptance trigger, which as we can see hit three global maximum here and two here out of 10 runs, and test results were obtained through a simulated annealing where the trigger was set at 0.5, which hit a number of 6 global maximums out of 10 runs. Of course, the time increased also for the convergence of the program. As a conclusion, we can successfully use a brute force algorithm to gather indications about the accuracy of the type of optimization algorithms we use. The brute force algorithm created using the PyAnsys software was faster than the same program developed in APDLE by an estimated 11% on our configuration, hardware configuration. We can use a simulated annealing approach in order to avoid being stuck on local maximums, which was the case for the greedy algorithm. These values that we got from the simulated annealing were better than the ones we got previously from the greedy algorithm, but they also does not always converge to a global maximum. Also, the parameters involved in defining the simulated annealing analysis are very important, and we should carefully use them, and it takes a longer time to compile than the greedy algorithm. As a future work, we intend to check how these algorithms work on wider domains, look for different methods to formulate the objective function, the temperature function, the acceptance function, and see how these influence our results. Also, if you would like to see the references, you can check these sources here. If there is anyone that has questions, we would gladly get in touch with you at the emails provided on this slide. This was my presentation. Thank you for everything.